as I fumble around with my equipment here. How about you stand? We'll join. We'll do some songs today.
You guys can go ahead and have a seat.
Oh yes, we won't make you stand for this, because boy, buckle up. Good morning. I am Rebecca, for those of you who don't know me. If you are new here, or sort of new here, or you're new again here, we would like to get to know you a little bit. We would like to connect with you, and a way to do that is you can scan that QR code on the back and click I'm new, or you can stop at our welcome table out in the front, and we have a gift for you just for saying thanks for being with us, and we'd like to connect with you sometime this week. So if you're new, sort of new again, please help us connect with you. In case anybody ever wondered what my favorite holiday is, happy birthday, America. I know a lot of people would say, but our country isn't what it once was, and I get that, but what our country was founded on and why the originals came over, why our ancestors came over, was for religious freedom. We still have that here. And that's really important. And we're celebrating that this week. We have the freedom to worship, and we have the freedom to study His word without fear of persecution. And that is something that we can be extremely, extremely thankful for. On the note of studying God's Word, we have a new young adult Bible study starting. This is for high school and beyond. The title of the study is called Doers of the Word. And it starts this Tuesday, July 2nd, and will run for 10 weeks through the summer. So if this fits where you're at in life, we would love for you to come out to that. It's from 6:30 to 7 on Tuesday evenings, starting this Tuesday. And you can go to Bridge Access on our website and just click on small groups and put in like young adult group or young adult Bible study or doers of the word. And that that will take you to the right place that will tell you like where it is and all the extra details. So there you go. Freedom to worship, freedom to study God's word. Family day is coming. 2 weeks, 2 weeks. Somebody last week said to me, well, I don't think I'm going to go because we wouldn't stay for the picnic anyway. And I'm going to tell you, even if you're not going to stay for the picnic after, come out to the worship service. We're going to do it in here this year. It's a combined service with our South Campus coming up, our Shores Campus. It is such a fun day, even if you can't stay for the picnic. But I'm going to run through a couple of details. Today is the final day to sign up for this. So if you want your cool Bridge t-shirt, today is the last day. So get on the website, click into Family Day, Bridge Access, and you should be able to do that. You can also access it from the QR code on the back of the pews here. So we will have a worship service with our music led by Heart Song from Cedarville. And then we will move on outside for the picnic portion. We'll have a bounce house for the kids. There will be a lot of fun things. So think of it as this, an old-fashioned church potluck kind of picnic. So we need a couple of things from you guys. We need you to register. We already talked about that. So go ahead and register if you haven't done that already. Put your t-shirt sizes in, and we'll get that ball rolling. The second thing that we need you to do is bring a dish or two to pass. Again, think good old-fashioned potluck picnic at a church. That's what we're going for. So the church will be providing all the meat, the hamburgers, hot dogs, and things that go along with that. But if you can bring a dish or two to pass, that will really help, and it is so much fun. And then you always end up like swapping recipes and stuff afterwards because that's just how it goes. So again, if you don't want to stay for the picnic, that is totally fine and we understand. I would encourage everybody to do it just because, well, it's fun and you get to interact with people that you wouldn't necessarily just because we all kind of sit in our same sections at church every Sunday morning. So it's a fun time to come out and just really family time. So come out for that next week. The service begins right here at 10:30. And I'm going to turn it back over to Eddie.
Thank you. Who's been to Family Day before? Majority of us, right? Who's excited for Family Day? Yeah. As it should be, right? So to give a, I always forget in the morning when I come and I say hello to everyone. Hey, my name's Eddie. I'm normally out at Shores. You've seen me here a million times, I'm sure, playing all the things. But, you know, I'm always excited for Family Day because I think about, you know, we come here and we South is going to come here. We're going to hang out with Dalton. And we always think about, like, Bridges, South, we got this campus here. I get the privilege to bounce around the campuses because of doing worship music and whatnot, and it's a fun perspective to think like to see Bridge is Bridge, right? We're all one. We're all one family, and we're all together. You know, when I look at Ephesians here on Ephesians 1:5, and it talks about how He, God, predestined us for adoption to sonship through Jesus Christ in accordance with His pleasure and will. You know, God loved us so much that He gave us His only Son, and so that whoever believes in Him can have eternal life. And the next song just really hammers home on that. So if you would please stand and join with me, we'll get into that.
Dry, drink of the water, come. cares no more. Come, all you sinners, come find his mercy. Come to the table, he will satisfy. Taste of his goodness, find what you're looking for. For God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. Is waiting there with open arms.
Yeah, with open arms.
For God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. God so loved the world. Praise God, praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him for the wonders of his love. Praise God, praise God. From whom all blessings flow. Praise him for the wonders of his love, his amazing love. For God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save us. For God so loved the world that he gave us. His one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. The power of hell forever defeated. Now it is well. I'm walking in freedom. For God so loved, God so loved the world. Bring your addictions, come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting, God so loved the world.
Our Savior, you're worthy of it all.
We give you the highest praise. We give you the highest praise. We give you the highest praise. Jesus, our Savior, you're worthy of it. my hands because I'm forgiven. I lift my hands because I'm set free. I lift my hands, a sign of surrender. Jesus, our Savior, you're worthy of it all. And we give you the highest praise. We give you the highest praise. We give you the highest praise. Jesus, our Savior, you're worthy of it all. I lift my eyes to look to your coming. I lift my eyes, I know you'll return. You will reign in glory forever.
I'm doing a quick interlude impromptu. Man, I am so glad that God loves me because the amount of mistakes I just made is tremendous. But it's a joyful noise, right? We're here to worship him, and we're going to do it some more.
In my place. poured out my sin erased. It was my death you died. I am raised to life. Hallelujah, the Lamb of God. For he's no greater love. There is no greater love. The Savior lifted up. There is no greater. Savior lifted up. There is no greater love. The Lamb of God in my place. Your blood poured out my sin erased. It was my death. I am raised to life. Hallelujah, the Lamb of God. The Lamb of God in my place. Your blood poured out my sin. Erased it was my death. You died. I am
Dear God, we are so thankful that we get to gather together and to worship you, and we're just so thankful that you are in our lives and you love us so much more than we could ever imagine. Lord, we just pray that you will just speak to us this morning and help open our hearts and minds, and we love you. Amen.
Well, it is good to be with you this morning. My name is Paul. If we haven't had a chance to meet, I would consider that a privilege to do that sometime after service or sometime during this week. Received a thank you in the mail this past week. It was from Muskegon Pregnancy Services. They're elated to share with our church that our recent fundraiser of $1,281.45 with the bottles that you all took home and filled up. That's how much we raised for that ministry. As a church, we support 9 local agencies, and so that was just a practical way where we can minister to one of our agencies in a different way. And so I wanted to relay their gratitude to you all for your generosity. If you'd ever like to give for various causes or whatever, you can do that through that QR code, or you can just drop your gift off. There's a box outside this side door over here, and you can just put it in there. We'll make sure it gets taken care of. One thing that I was thinking about this past week, I was really, really, really thankful that we had a new roof on this building. I came in, and surprisingly, well, not really surprisingly, we were dry all the way in the back hallways, and I was so thankful for that. So thank you for those of you who continue to give to our roof project. We are making some headway, but we have a ways to go with that. So if you'd like to donate to that, just put on their Dalton Roof Project, and we'll make sure that that gets credited to that account as well. Well, every single one of us has regrets in life. Maybe this past week, some of your regrets involved not having a generator. That might have been on your list. Some of us went out and bought one at premium prices, I'm sure, to preserve our food. But we all have regrets. Some of the regrets we may have, words we've spoken. Sometimes we said the wrong thing at the wrong time, or maybe we said what we actually meant to say, but later looking back on it, we said, I probably shouldn't have said that. Probably should have kept my mouth shut then. But we have regrets with the words we say. We have regrets with financial choices we've made. Some of the things we thought were a great deal turned out not to be a great deal. And we said, man, I wish we didn't do that. I wish we didn't spend money like that. Or maybe it was a relational decision. You gave part of your heart away to somebody thinking that that person was going to be in your corner forever, and they broke it off with you, and you can never get that part of your heart back. And that's just a regret relationally. I think we all have regrets. But there is one decision that we could all make that's regret-free. There's one decision that we could all make, and that's to follow Jesus as the leader of our lives. That is a choice that we'll never regret. Why? Because Jesus is the leader we will never regret following. Jesus and following him makes all the difference in our lives. But listen to how he describes himself in John chapter 10. He says, I am the good shepherd. I'm the good shepherd. He is a leader of us. This is the fourth statement of our series. We've been looking through the book of John for the past about 3 or 4 weeks now, and they all start with I am, and then he fills in a character quality. And as we could remember, in the earlier parts of the series, we know that that phrase, I am, means he is claiming to be God. That is a phrase designated strictly for God. And so whenever you see Jesus use that phrase, he says, I am God, and here's a character quality I want you to learn. I am God, and in this case, he says, I am the good shepherd. He's in the middle of a conversation with a group of people, and he's trying to explain to this crowd of people that he alone is the good shepherd. But he's contrasting himself as the good shepherd with other people who have ascribed to themselves the shepherds of Israel. And while he says that I'm a good shepherd, we normally understand that to be he's morally upright. He's teaching us good things. He says, I am the standard. But then he says, I'm the shepherd. And he was a tender of not sheep or goats, but of people. Jesus says, I am not like the others around you. I am the good shepherd. So he's trying to help people understand this. So in verse 11 continues, he goes, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. He who is a hired hand and not a shepherd, who does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees. The wolf snatches them and scatters them. He flees because he is a hired hand and cares nothing for his sheep. Could you imagine the scene before you? Here's Jesus talking to a group of people, the religious leaders who are supposed to be the shepherd of the people of Israel. They're standing there right with them. And Jesus comes in and he says, I'm the guy. I'm the good shepherd. You all are the hired hands. You're supposed to care for the people of God, but you don't. I could just imagine the intensity mounting as they're having this debate between the two parties. He goes, they don't care about you, but I do. In fact, I care so much about you that I'm going to give you some reasons why you can follow me and trust me. And the very first one is because Jesus sacrificed himself to give life. So many times, if you've grown up in the church or if you've been around, you hear this and you say, yeah, Jesus sacrificed himself. He died on the cross. Lots of people know that Jesus died on the cross. And it's almost as if we gloss over that one part. You're like, yeah, I get that. Get to the good stuff. But how can we get over that? How can we just gloss over the fact that Jesus gave his life so that we could have life? Just stop for a second. And think about it. Jesus, the miracle worker. Jesus, the person who created the heavens and the earth. Jesus, who knows all things, says, I am the good shepherd, and I am going to give my life for you. Do you marvel at that? Do you wake up every morning thinking, wow, the creator of the heavens and the earth gave his life for me so much that I can't even get my head wrapped around it. We should never, ever get over this. He was afflicted on our behalf. He was gossiped and rumored about. His reputation was tarnished, and he just did this strictly to give us life. He says, this is the way I am going to make a path to God the Father. Think about this. The night when he was betrayed, he was out in a garden with his disciples. And he's kneeling in prayer. And he says, God, Father, if there's any way for this cup to pass me, let it be so. And he was so stressed, his soul was in so much anguish, he is literally sweating drops of blood. He says, if there's any way possible, let this pass, but not my will, but yours be done. He has this conversation with God, and God the Father says, this is the way. And he takes it. He stands, he sees his accuser before him. And as his accuser comes before him, he betrays him and he's led away. And Jesus willingly sacrifices himself for us, being humiliated and nailed to a cross for all to see after he received an incredible beating. So he sacrificed so much for us. He sacrificed his comfort for us. Think about it. Jesus, he was in the glories of heaven with the streets of gold where there's no crying and no pain and no sorrow, no nothing. He was receiving the worship of the angels. He was there in all of the glory. And he says, you know what? For the sake of the people, I'm coming down from the glories of heaven and I'm coming into this earth. And he's not coming with the proud shoulders of a man. He comes in with a very dependent child, a baby. He had to learn how to walk, and he had to learn how to do life as a child does. He put away his godness for a moment, and then he developed like we all do. He gave up the glories and the riches of heavens, and he became a son of a peasant person, a carpenter. As he grew up, he didn't have a home. He was homeless. He had all the riches in heaven, and he says, nope, that's not what we're doing here. We're not building little kingdoms down here. I'm ushering them into the presence of God, and I'm giving up every possible thing for them. He sacrificed his comfort. He sacrificed his energy. There's a lot of times when he was on his ministries on this earth, he's walking around and he's ministering to people and he's healing people and he's teaching people. And if you've ever had to do that, that can be very exhausting, teaching and dealing with people. It's emotional and it's taxing on the person. And Jesus is just doing it constantly. He's doing. And finally he'd pull back and goes, I need a break. I need a rest. I need to pray. And he'd withdraw from the crowds. He'd pray and get refreshed, and then he'd come back in, and he gave up his energy. He gave up his reputation. He sacrificed his reputation. You know why? Because Jesus wasn't going after the people that society went after. He went after the outcasts, people that some of us may be even embarrassed to talk about. He would go towards the prostitutes and the drunks and the tax collectors, and that day they were like the lowest of low. And they said, I'm going to have dinner with you people. You're my people. Those people that look nice, he goes, I'm not really going to go after them. So he gave up his reputation. He had dinner with them, and those people over there were saying, how can he call himself a rabbi associating with those people over there? And yet this is what our Savior does, because he's not looking for a popularity contest. He's saying, I'm seeking anybody who needs help. And he opens this up, but he didn't care about his reputation. That's not what he was going for. And I sit back and I ask, how can we ever get used to the fact that Jesus sacrificed himself for us? See, this is the good news of Jesus. And as he comes to scene, he says, I'm the good shepherd, and I'm willingly giving my life for every single person. No one's forcing me to do this. I'm laying it down willfully. Yet within this, there's a danger. There's a danger, and this is the danger of thinking that we happen to be the most important person. We think, man, look at all the stuff that Jesus gave up for me. Look at this. I must be somebody of importance. And it's like, no. The object is on Jesus. It is not on me. We all have a bunch of responsibilities. Some of us have a lot of responsibilities, and some of us, by comparison, have few responsibilities, but we all have responsibilities. And inside of those responsibilities, we may think we're pretty important. If we don't show up to work, things are going to probably shut down. And some of us, actually, that's probably true. But I don't care about how many responsibilities you have, how many I have. Guess what? We're all sheep. We're just little animals. I'll tell you, sheep are not the brightest animals in the world. If you look at them, they were not designed for much of anything. Their armor, think about it. What's their armor? Do they have any armor? Nope, they have a blanket. That's it. Just wool. You look at their legs. Are they nice and powerful? Nope, they're like twigs. They're sitting there, pretty defenseless little creatures, right? And that's all we are. That's why we need a shepherd, because we don't have what it takes to make it through this life on our own. We're not that important, but we are the object of the good shepherd. So that gives us a little bit of importance. But Jesus is the one that we should be casting our vision to. See, Jesus protects us from bad managers and attacks. Let's return to verse 12. In verse 12, he says, he who is a hired hand and not a shepherd, who does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees. The wolf snatches them and then scatters them. He flees because he's a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. Now, for me, you may guess that I'm not a shepherd of animals. I have a struggle with keeping fish alive. This would not be something I'm really well-versed in, but I read a whole lot, and so I started to learn a little bit about what it means to be a shepherd, especially in the ancient context. These people, these shepherds, what they would do is they would invest a large amount of their energy, their time, and their money into the well-being of their sheep. They said, this is my flock, and they've got names, and I know them by name, and I know how each one's made. I've got a vested interest. This is my livelihood. But obviously, the shepherd couldn't always be with his sheep, and so what they would do is they would hire somebody to come in and watch over the flock while they were away on business or visiting family or whatever it was. And so as the shepherd would hire this person, they would say, I want you to caretake for these sheep. And what would happen is, off in the distance, they could see the predators coming. They're like, whoa. There's a wolf coming, and he wants some mutton for supper. He wants some lamb. And he goes, who am I to stand in his way? Better the sheep than me, right? That's a hired hand. The shepherd will say, not on my life. I'm going to kill that wolf. But the hired hand, they don't care. They don't care about the sheep. They said, have at it. You want to? Be my guest. Take him away. It's better them than me. See, bad managers are more concerned about themselves than others. They're more concerned about themselves than others. They're asking at the end of the day, what's in it for me? How much does it pay? Is it worth it? And for the false shepherds or the managers, they would say, you know what? I'm going with this as long as I can, but the moment conflict happens, the moment a stressor happens, I'm gone. I'm not going to walk with you through that. I'm out of here. The shepherd they were following were more concerned with themselves. You know, in this context, if we went back to chapter 9 and the earlier part of chapter 10, you know what's happening? Jesus just performed a miracle. Jesus healed a blind person. Remember this? He knelt down and he made some mud in the ground with his spit and he rubbed it on his eyes and he said, go wash, and he went and washed. And so he came back and his eyes were, he could see everything, and he's had a day of discovery as he could see for the first time in his life. Caught the attention of the religious leaders. The religious leaders start to question him and said, what happened? How did this happen? And he said, a man named Jesus healed my eyes. And you know what they did? They booted him. They kicked him out simply because he said, Jesus healed me. They didn't care about him. They said, you're no longer able to worship with us. You're no longer allowed to come to the synagogue and worship. You're out because you gave credit to Jesus. See, these bad managers would protect themselves at the expense of others. They pushed them out. They said, I want the prestige of being the guy in charge. I want to read for you from the book of Ezekiel. This is Ezekiel 34. This is the word of the Lord that came to me, to Ezekiel. Son of man, prophesy against the shepherds of Israel. Prophesy and say to them, even to the shepherds, thus says the Lord God, ah, shepherds of Israel, who have you been feeding yourselves? Should not shepherds feed the sheep? You eat the fat, you clothe yourself with the wool, you slaughter the fat ones, but you do not feed the sheep. The weak you have not strengthened, the sick you have not healed, the injured you have not bound up, the strayed you have not brought back, the lost you have not sought, and in forced harshness you have ruled them. So they were scattered because there was no shepherd, and they became food for all the wild beasts. My sheep were scattered. They wandered over all the mountains and over every high hill. My sheep were scattered over all the face of the earth with none to search or seek for them. For thus says the Lord God, behold, I myself will search for my sheep and will seek them out. As a shepherd seeks out his flock when he is among his sheep that have been scattered, so I will seek out my sheep, and I will rescue them from all the places where they have been scattered on a day of clouds and thick darkness. And I will bring them out from the peoples and gather them from the countries and will bring them into their own land. I will feed them on the mountains of Israel, by the ravines and all of the inhabited places of the country. I will feed them with good pasture, and on the mountain heights of Israel shall be their grazing land. They shall lie down in good grazing land, and on rich pasture they shall feed on the mountains. I myself will be the shepherd of my sheep. I myself will make them lie down, declares the Lord God. I will seek the lost. I will bring back the strayed, and I will bind up the injured, and I will strengthen the weak, the fat, and the strong I will destroy. I will feed them in justice. This is the good shepherd. He said, you have all of these people over here who are claiming to be good shepherds, but he goes, they don't care. I care. I'm going to find the weak ones. I'm going to find the sick ones. I'm going to restore them, and I'm going to get them into a relationship with God. And so through this, we say, ah, man, I kind of want to sign up with Jesus. He is going to lead me in a path that's better than where other people will lead me. I want to go with Jesus because it seems like that's a better future for me. That just is on a logical progression based off of what I've seen in Scripture here. But there's a danger. The danger is assuming that there will be no difficulties in life. There will be no difficulties in life at all. That's the danger in this thinking. One of the most well-known Psalms is Psalm 23. Most of us, even if we haven't been in a lot of religious gatherings or worship services like this, a lot of us could start kicking out parts of Psalm 23. It's commonly read at funerals. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. In the presence of my enemies, you anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Man, I love the 23rd Psalm. I do. I love the fact that I have a shepherd who's leading me with grace and helping me in my weakness. But did you catch verse 4 and 5? Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, that does not sound like the top 10 vacation destinations in my book. I'm like, man, Jesus, you can lead me to like the tropical paradise. That sounds kind of nice. We can get away from stuff and we can just enjoy and relax and have a wonderful time sitting on the beach and relaxing. That sounds wonderful. But he says, I'm going to lead you and I'm going to lead you to the valley of the shadow of death. And I'm like, what? I don't want that. But I do want when it follows up. I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Even as we experience the hardships of life, even as we go through even something as hard as death, we don't fear because our good shepherd's there leading us. Did you catch what he said? He goes, in the presence of my enemies, you are preparing a table before me. I like that idea. All the food that I want, and it's going to be like this gourmet five-course meal. It's going to be awesome. And he said, I'm doing this. I'm going to prepare your table. In fact, I'm going to give you so much drink that it's going to overflow, and the blessings of God are going to overflow in your life. It's going to be wonderful. But did you catch where this is at? He goes, in the presence of my enemies, you do this. The people that hate me, the ones that say all kinds of evil against me, who wish me harm. And he goes, yeah, that's all going on, and that's not going to be pleasant. But don't worry about it. I'm preparing a table for you. I'm going to watch over you. I'm going to give you blessing upon blessing, even in the midst of that. I said, man, my good shepherd, he is going to lead me through every aspect of life, the good times and the hard times. And we walk through this, and we say, yes, I have a good shepherd. See, this good shepherd doesn't call it quits on us. We have a hard time sometimes with our faith and our faithfulness, right? But not God. Sometimes we start to look to people and Jesus says they're going to let you down. We have this group of people that he's kind of in their face at right now. And then Jesus says, I'm protecting you from that. See, people will turn their backs on us, but God doesn't. People will say hurtful things towards you. They won't say the right things at the right time. They do things to hurt you. He goes, I won't do that. I will give you the encouragement that you need. I'll correct you, don't get me wrong, but I will give you the encouragement you need. People will use you and make you feel terrible in the process, but he says, I'm the good shepherd. I'm going to come to you. My good is better than your best. That's what he's getting at. See, our good shepherd is here for us, but listen to how Jesus continues to talk about himself. He goes, I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, I lay down my life for the sheep. See, Jesus knows everything about us. He knows everything about us, and it causes me to wonder about my life because there's times where we do really, really good at shielding our life from people. Don't we? We're really, really good about saying, hey, here's my work life over here, and I have my work friendships, and I have my relationships at work, and they're nice, and they think I'm nice, and this is great. And then we punch out, and we come home, and then we have our family life, and they know me in a certain way, and that's kind of cool. I'm dad and a husband and all that. And then we have our friends, and they know me and my friend in that sphere of area. And then we look at all these areas, and they rarely ever intersect. So our friends over in this category don't really know our work friends. We're the common denominator between them. And so that means I can act one way at work and totally different when I'm over here. We shield it out. And yet what we see from here is that Jesus knows all of it. The stuff that we are okay with the public knowing and the sins and the struggles that we try to hide from everybody, he knows it all. And he still says, I am here to lead you. He can tell when his sheep aren't well, when they're sick, or when they need to be carried. He knows exactly where his sheep are at. When we need help, he knows what we need when it's needed. See, our good shepherd knows us. He actually knows our names. He knows our names. It's mind-boggling to me. There's billions of people in this world, and he can look around the room, and he can call every single one of us out by name. He could say, hey, Bob, hey, Bruce, hey, Melissa, and he gets it right every time. I'm a dad. I got 3 kids. Do you know how hard it is to call the right kid at the right time? I'm like, Chase, Max. Yup, I included my dog in the roll call. To my shame. I'm like, you get over here. I need you. You know, like, I have a struggle with 3. And he knows us and the billions of faces that are in the world. He knows my name and it blows my mind. He knows not only our names, but he knows our makeup. We read in Psalms that he put us together in our mother's wombs. He crafted us. He says, I want you to have curly hair, and I want you to have no hair, and I want you to have straight hair. He did this. He goes, I'm giving you these kinds of emotions and this kind of temperament, and you're going to be able to do these kinds of things, and here's your natural abilities, and I'm just putting it all together. And you look around the world and you say, who else there is like me? And I'm unique. All of us are. Even identical twins aren't identical. We know this. And God says, I put all of you together. See, God knows not only our names and our makeup, but he knows the significant and insignificant aspects of our lives. If we read in the book of Luke, we know that he knows the number of hairs that are on our heads. I think that's ridiculous. Like, why waste your time knowing that? I don't get it. But he does. He gets that part of our lives. But if he knows those little details of our lives, how much more do you think he knows about what's going on us emotionally and physically, spiritually? He knows every aspect of our lives. He loves us. He gets us. He knows his own, and his own know him. Did you follow that? In this passage, he says, I know my own, and my own know me. So when he talks, guess what? His sheep listen. Sometimes we get so busy in our lives that we don't stop or slow down far enough and fast enough to actually hear from God. We go from one thing to the next. We look at our calendars, and they're just jam-packed with event after event after event. And we don't pause to say, God, what do you want from me? How are you trying to speak to me? What are you trying to teach me in this moment? And we're just pedal to the floor the whole time, and we're saying, I'm just going to get it all done, get it all done, get it all done. He goes, hold up. I want you to hear my voice. I want you to hear me. See, God has chosen to talk to us through his Holy Spirit. In John 14, Jesus is instructing the crowds. He says, you know what? In just a little while, I'm going to depart from this earth, meaning his death and resurrection. That's what he's getting at. And as he leaves, he says, I'm promising you, I'm not going to leave you on your own. You don't have to do this on your own. I'm going to give you another helper. His name is the Holy Spirit. And he is going to reside in you for those of you who are followers of me. I'm going to give him to you. And he's going to guide you. And he's going to direct you. And he's going to confront you. And he's going to help you get through life. And so we hear the voice of God through those promptings. Some of us have heard that. And we're like, I swear I heard an audible voice telling me to go here. And some of us are like, I've felt nudges and promptings. And I'm just letting you know that's probably the Holy Spirit. Now here's the clarification. The Holy Spirit will never contradict what's in the scriptures. He'll never go against what's found in our Bible. So as you hear these voices or you hear the promptings, you feel those promptings, you say, man, is this in line with Scripture? What's God's revealed to us in His Word? And He says, yeah, I think it is. So I can give generously, or I can live sacrificially, or I can help somebody else in need because I feel like God's putting that in my heart to go help somebody out. This past week, we could be doing that, right? A lot of trees needed to be cut up. We could be just finding those little promptings of God and going helping our neighbors out in the time of this past storm. So maybe the Holy Spirit prompted you in that direction. We follow the Holy Spirit's promptings, but God also reveals to us His Word in the Bible. That's how He communicates with us. So we read it, and we ingest it, and we just get it in. And I'll tell you, the older I've gotten, the more I realize that God wants us to walk with Him. And when I was younger, I used to look at the Bible as kind of almost like a textbook of here's all the answers, or here's all the rules of the do's and the don'ts. You need to do this, and you need to stop doing this. And it was just like this almost academic exercise. But as I started to grow up and mature, I started to realize, you know what? This is actually God's plan to having the best life possible. When we start to read our Bibles and we start to look at it and we say, man, God's going to be glorified in this. I'm going to learn about who God is. But if I follow what He's instructing me to do, it saves me from a lot of heartache if I just simply apply the principles He has outlined in Scriptures. This year, in about a month, a little over a month, Katie and I are celebrating 16 years. Love it. Love that lady. Love her a lot. I have no problem saying this. Some of you say, 16 years, that's it? I've been married for 30 or 40 or 50. And yet some of you can even say, I've been married for over 60 years. And I'm thinking, that's impressive. I don't care how we cut it, that's impressive. It takes a lot of work to hit those kind of numbers. But I guarantee you, if you talk to somebody who's been married for a while, I guarantee you they've applied the principles of Scripture into their marriage. Guaranteed. Because inside of them, they say, you know what? We're going to flee youthful lust. That's what Paul says to the young pastor, Timothy. He said, I want you to flee youthful lust. Do you know getting up to those kind of numbers in your marriage is actually achievable? But it also says, I need you not to get down paths that are going to take you out. Lust would be one of them. Not only, but that's one of them. If we're going to have a good long marriage, we have to fight some of those other temptations and say, you know what? I'm saying no to that. And now some of us, we may think, why would I say no? It's a little harmless, isn't it? But I'll tell you, it destroys marriage after marriage after marriage. I've seen it happen. You say, God doesn't want that from you. He wants to give you the best life. And so right now, we just draw a line in the sand and said, man, I don't know about all your paths. We're just drawing it. He said, to the best of my ability, I want to see if I can follow God's principles throughout Scripture. And I want to preserve that. I'm not going to look at it as God just trying to zap me for doing the wrong actions. But I'm just saying, God, why would you say no, have me say no to that? Maybe it's to preserve something far better. I tell you, the danger in all of this is believing you are His sheep if you don't follow His voice. That's the danger. Sometimes people point to activities and says, I'm one of God's sheep because I went to a church service or because I memorized some verses or because I prayed a prayer or because I did something or maybe I didn't do anything too bad and I'm one of God's people. But in truth, the good shepherd is the one who can say something to us and we live accordingly. If we fail to follow through on that, then it questions whether or not we are one of His sheep. Yeah, I'm just curious, can you point to a time where you can honestly say, I'm doing this action because I believe this is what God wants from me. This is where I want God, or how I can honor God. Sometimes when we start to do this, it starts to sound crazy to those around us who aren't a part of a faith community. Years ago, I worked at a retail store. Every person in that business knew that I wanted to be a pastor. And so they would always ask me these religious questions. Oh, it would just be random. I was like, hey, let's ask the religious guy. He's kind of crazy. Let's ask him. And so they would ask me questions. And one day my boss was there and he's like, so Paul, got a question for you. I'm like, yep. He goes, do you give money to your church? And I said, yes, I do. He goes, how much? He puts me on the spot. He wants to know my financial dealings with my church. At the time, I just punched for it. At the time, I felt convicted during that phase of my life, by the Holy Spirit, to live sacrificially, to live generously, and to give money as much as I could away. So at the time, I was giving about 12% of my yearly income to the church. That's what I was up to. And I said that to him, and he goes, 12%? He was dumbfounded by this. He goes, that's a lot. And I went on to explain. I said, here's what I understood. I said, where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. I said, God doesn't need my money. My church doesn't need my money. They really don't. It's always amazing to watch how God provides. But I'm doing this for my own worship, to make sure that my heart is never consumed with stuff, to give back to God, to say, God, you've got my heart, and I'm going to take a portion of my income and give that back to you as a demonstration of that. He said, man, that's crazy. I said, yep, I know. But I looked at those moments, and that's not the only one, but I look at moments like that and say, people outside of a faith community think that's ridiculous. And I said, but that's the voice of God. He asks me to do some things that others will deem ridiculous. So as we do life, I'm just curious, have you listened to the voice of God, and what is he calling you to do? But Jesus continues in verse 16. He says, and I have other sheep that are not of this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. There will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason, the Father loves me, because I lay down my life that I may take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down on my own accord. I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it up again. This charge I have received from my Father. See, our good shepherd is concerned with all people, and Jesus actually unifies us with others. Jesus was talking to a Jewish audience at this point. He was talking to them, and as he talks with this Jewish audience, they were looking for a Jewish Messiah. They didn't really care about the other peoples of the world, but Jesus was expanding their view, and he's saying, hey, listen up. I'm the Savior of all. I'm the good shepherd for all who believe in me. And so as Jesus comes, he says, I want you to understand that there's going to be other people that are going to be coming in to the family of God. They're not going to be of Jewish descent, which I am eternally thankful for, because I'm not Jewish. And I find hope in the resurrected Christ. He wants us to bring this message to others. He wants us to bring the message that Jesus came and he died on a cross for the sins of the world, that he defeated death and rose again, and one day he's going to return. And until that day comes, we are busy spreading this good news to everybody we have around us. And we're united on that purpose. See, as Christ followers, he has given us the ministry of reconciliation. He has given us the ministry of reconciliation. The Apostle Paul tells us that if God has reached into your life and he's given you the forgiveness, then he goes, I want you to take that message to anybody and everybody, and I want you to reconcile them not only with each other, but I want you to reconcile them with God. And I'll tell you, I've witnessed so many people hurt at the hands of Christians. We should not be those types of people. Our purpose in this world is to bring others to God, not push them away from God. We should say, you know what, I'm going to keep my words in check. I'm going to keep my actions in check, because I want people to come to God. I want them to connect with God. I don't want anything to distract them from coming to God. And yet there's a spirit that can happen in Christians where we hurt one another, our family members, our brothers and sisters in Christ. And when that happens, there's a spirit of bitterness that sets in, and there's an unwillingness to own the mistake. There's an unwillingness to accept apologies. And so we have their side and our side, and we sit on this side, and they sit on that side, and it's like the Hatfield and McCoys all came to church. I said, no, 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 no. We've been given the ministry of reconciliation. We should be coming together, and we should figure out, it's like, hey, do you believe in God? Do you believe in Jesus? Yeah, so do I. So we're on the same team. Let's figure this thing out. And yet so many times we just divide and we say, it's not worth the effort. It's not worth the effort of coming together and to be united on purpose. We get upset with someone and say, it's not worth it. But as a follower of Christ, we can never buy into the attitude that they don't deserve my forgiveness. Jesus willingly laid down his life for us. How can we withhold that from other people? My sin is far greater than whatever anybody has ever done to me. And he says, you've been forgiven, so therefore forgive other people. Jesus is the good shepherd, and we need to follow his example. We need to follow his teaching. And Jesus is calling us to love others. He's calling us to do this. within the faith community and within the greater community at large and with and true of the entire world. And we have outreach partners that go around the world on our behalf. Our Serve Italy team's over in Milan right now, serving Jesus thousands of miles away from us, carrying the same message to a group of people that speak a different language, that have a different cultural customs, and they're doing this. So this is what we're called to do. But this call from Jesus, this calling us to love other people, begs the question, what does that call require? It requires us giving of ourselves. It requires us to be forgiving. It requires us to give our time and our energy. It requires us to treat other people the way we want to be treated, to pardon offenses and to extend grace when we don't feel like it. This is the kind of life Jesus is calling us to, that we should be unified. But if we're not careful, we may find ourselves picking sides and lifting someone else's burden and offense. Instead of seeking reconciliation, we say, I'm team so-and-so, and I'm team so-and-so, and we just fight. See, the danger is that we follow a personality instead of Christ. We follow someone who may have the ability to move the crowds with their voice, to get followers, if you will. And instead of following Christ, and the older I get, the more sensitive I get towards preserving the glory of Christ. I hear a lot of people quoting other people more than quoting Jesus. And that is alarming to me. It's like, yeah, I read this book over here and it was great. There's great insights. And did you hear what this author said? This was great. It's like, yeah, but what did Jesus say? We're so quick to hit the New York Times bestseller list and we get all these books and we fill our libraries and we learn all their stuff and we digest their stuff. We jump on the internet and we start reading articles and blogs and say, man, this person makes a lot of sense. But what does Jesus say? How do we not quote him? The most prolific person in all of history, the one that's most famous of all of history. Do we quote him? And sometimes we even do something a little bit different. We start to say, well, I'm going to quote Jesus. And we take out our Bible verses and we start clubbing people with it. And we say, no, 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 that's not what the Bible is for. We don't follow personalities. We don't act as the gatekeepers. We just simply know Jesus. And unfortunately, what we often want is the a la carte religious experience. We don't want to get inside the context where Jesus is telling us to go. And so this is what happens a lot of times. We like the preaching of this guy, so we go to that church for the teaching. We like the youth ministry of this other church because they can do some crazy things with the kids. We like the small groups of yet another body of believers, and so we go to that small group. We like the kids' ministry of there, so we go there on Wednesday night, so that we can have a well-rounded religious experience. But do you know that God is bringing us together as a body? For better or worse, we're together. He goes, I want you to be united. I want you to walk with each other. And yes, we don't always see eye to eye. That's okay. We can still love each other. And actually, we're better for it. We get sharpened in the process. And so we come together. And I'm not saying that it's wrong to interact with other Christians. It's not what I'm saying at all. But Jesus says, I want you to come together and to work together because there's something that happens when you put people together. I read a book a long time ago. Here I go quoting another guy. He goes, what if the purpose of marriage is to make you holy and not happy? What if God brought us together as a body to make us holy? And so in order to make us holy, he has to chip away at the hard parts of our life. And in order to do that, you need to be here. And you need to voice up in small group. And you need to share your perspective. And you may feel like you're out on your own with this. You're like, I don't know, this is treading into some uncomfortable spots. I have to open up part of my heart and I may get looks at and people are like, what? I didn't think about that. And I'm not sure how they're going to respond. He says, yes, I get that. But you've been called to a body. We don't follow personalities. We follow Christ. We are not the gatekeepers. We are simply sheep and our responsibility is to follow the good shepherd. This is where our comfort starts to come. This is why following Jesus is the best decision we can make, why it doesn't lead to regret. So many times we think, man, I've got to do all this stuff. But really, we're just coming to Jesus. And so there's two steps that we should take this week. Number one, we got to come to Jesus. We have to come to Jesus. Some of us, we need to come to Jesus for the very first time. And what I mean by that is you've come and maybe you're here for the first time. Maybe you came to church kicking and screaming. Maybe you just showed up because you just didn't have anything better to do 10:30 on a Sunday morning and you're just here. Maybe you just tuned in just because you're at home and you're thinking, man, I'll just watch a little church service right now, and you stumbled on us. For that, I'm very thankful that you've chosen us. But at the same time, you need to come to Jesus. And so to come to Jesus for the very first time, this is what you need to do. You say, you know what? I'm a sinner. I've done a whole bunch of stuff that I regret. I've done a whole bunch of stuff that I wish I could go back and redo, but I can't, so I have to own it. I'm a sinner, and I need a Savior. So we come and we confess that before God. As we confess, we also acknowledge that Jesus came and paid a very steep price for our salvation. He died on a cross and rose again. And so when we get right with God, we say, God, I'm sorry for sinning. I trust that Jesus died on the cross. I'm choosing him as my Lord and Savior. That's it. That's how we start. But I wonder, for some of us who may have been walking with Jesus for a while, do you come to Jesus on a regular basis? That should be on our minds when we wake up. We should be going through our days thinking, how can I know Jesus more? Or how can I reflect him more today? How can I make choices that would honor him and to come to him and to say, God, I'm about ready to go into work. I need you to work through me today as I enter into the workplace. I need you to give me words to speak to my coworkers as I go in to that job site. I need you to use my voice to glorify you. Help me not to say things I'm not supposed to say. Help me not to swear, and help me to not talk about other things that they're talking about. Help me to just be clear with what I'm doing in this life. Thank you for this job, and let me honor you in it today. I'm coming to him. That's what we need to do every single day. Secondly, we need to follow his leading. We need to follow his leading. We need to look and say, you know what? My sheep hear my voice, and my sheep hear my voice, and they respond. They listen to me. So as we follow Jesus, we're saying, you know what? I'm going to follow wherever he's leading. So as a follower of Jesus, we don't get to say things like, they really wronged me, so I'm allowed to be permanently angry with them. Or, I know I'm supposed to love them, but they are really annoying to me. Or, whenever I'm around them, they embarrass me, so therefore I don't have to love them. Or, they don't agree with me, so I'm allowed to use cutting language and post my displeasure about their business on my Facebook page. Or, this is a difficult season, so therefore I deserve to lose my self-control and eat and drink whatever I want until I'm good. Jesus says, show your love for God by loving others. And for Jesus, he is saying, I am the good shepherd. Follow me. He says, I want you to follow me every single day. This is why following Jesus is not simply a suggestion, but it is a choice that will lead to no regrets. Father in heaven, thank you so much for loving us this morning. Loving us permanently. It's not just today. Thank you that you've loved us, that you've instructed us. Thank you that you've given us these statements and that we can follow you. Lord, I ask that you would help us to do that. It's easy to sit here for a few minutes and to think about it. It's harder when we leave this room and we have problems at home and problems at work to honor you. And I just ask that you do help us to do our part to honor you this week. It's in your son's name we pray. Amen.
Again, just thanks so much for allowing me to come and do worship with you all this morning. This next song that Joni's going to lead us in, it's a good reminder that regardless of our circumstance, God is here for us and he will not forsake us.
Of course.
show. Not for a moment did you forsake me. Not for a moment will you forsake me. And after all, you are constant. And after all, you are only good. And after all, you are sovereign. Not for a moment did you forsake me. Not for a moment did you forsake me. In every step, every breath, you are there. Every tear, every cry, for a moment will you forsake me. Not for a moment will you forsake me. Oh, you are good.
Thank you so much for being here with us this morning. Thank you for worshiping with us. If you need to know what your next step is in your faith walk, there is the next room right outside here, and we've got a team of people that are there to that are happy to speak with you and help you. Otherwise, we will see you here again next week.